hear me okay? Good, great. Well, listen, thanks for coming out tonight for the lecture. It's a very special lecture for me for first reason, first time I've shared the stage with Laura. I'm really looking forward to that. And also, it's a lecture about Cuba, my favorite place on the planet. You'll see why during the lecture. And you know, it's nothing like a little talk about Cuba to bring out the riffraff. You know? So let's get started here. Topics we're going to talk about tonight, we're going to start with the definition of eutrophication, just so you all fully understand exactly what this term means. Then we're going to move on to a little history of Cuba and Guantanamo Bay in particular, that whole history of the Spanish-American War, sinking of the USS Maine. The very special role that Guantanamo Bay played in that. Then we're going to move on to my personal history of Cuba, something I've never really talked about in any lecture before. And then we're going to move on to the phase one nutrient study when I first began working at Guantanamo Bay in 2011. Then got invited back, and that's when I went back with Laura, and she's going to take the stage, talk about our trip just last year, and what we're doing down there right now. She'll also talk about the biodiversity of Cuba. It's amazing biodiversity, largest island in the Caribbean. Laura's got some great information to share with you about that. And we'll wrap up with the future plans of our program with the Navy and also with our Cuban colleagues in light of the new travel rules pertaining to Cuba. So, eutrophication, what's it all about? Algae. We define this term as scientists as an increase in the rate of supply of organic matter in an ecosystem. So it's a process by which a water body acquires high concentrations of nutrients such as nitrogen and phosphorus. The symptoms include, and I know many of you understand this because this is happening to our own Indian River Lagoon, harmful algal blooms, such as the brown tides and the super blooms that we've had here in the lagoon, reduced dissolved oxygen that ultimately can lead to dead zones, reduced biodiversity, fisheries, seagrass, and coral reef die-off. It is a natural process that actually goes very slowly in the absence of humans, and of course, humans introduce sources of nutrients such as sewage, agricultural runoff, fertilizers, topsoil, that accelerates this process. And in the case where the humans become involved, we actually call this cultural eutrophication. Now, we all think of nutrients as a good thing. We all need nutrients to grow. So what we're talking about here in terms of our coastal waters, it's really too much of a good thing. So the cultural eutrophication in Cuba and the world really began with the indigenous peoples, and that's certainly the case here, where the Taino, the indigenous people in Cuba, were the first to begin putting together villages where they were concentrating their waste. And so on a very small scale compared to the much larger populations today, that's where the cultural eutrophication really began a long time ago. Now, where we're going tonight, Guantanamo Bay, you can see the red star in southeast Cuba. This is a region known as Oriente. And you can see the classic distribution of the Taino actually came in to this section of Cuba that includes Guantanamo Bay. The Taino were the principal inhabitants of most of Cuba when Columbus arrived, and they were in conflict with the Caribs that are down here in the Lesser Antilles. And many of the cities we know in Cuba today, Havana, Camagüey, Baracoa, Bioma, they all take their names from Taino names. Now, they became extinct as a culture due to infectious diseases, smallpox in particular, and also to Spanish atrocities. So the history of the naval station at Guantanamo Bay really began just prior to the Spanish-American War. At that time, Cuba was going through a rebellion against the Spanish. This was led by Jose Marti and General Maximo Gomez. And we were drawn into the war, the U.S., following the sinking of the USS Maine. I think many of you probably know, we don't really know exactly why the Maine, USS Maine sank, but there was some yellow journalism involved with the New York Times, and it didn't matter because the Spanish were blamed. So that led to the first shots of the Spanish-American War taking place in Guantanamo Bay. The cruiser Marblehead arrived with the Captain McCullough, who began firing on actually what's known as McCullough Point today, shown in this top picture. And the Spaniards called in some reinforcements. The Sandoval, this Spanish gunboat, sailed from the upper part of Guantanamo Bay to engage the Marblehead, only to see those 6-inch guns, and it retreated back up into the upper parts of the bay. June 14th, U.S. Marines that were dispatched from Key West, Florida, together with Cuban forces, attacked the Spanish at Cusco, which is where the Spanish forces were concentrated. There were about 800 Spaniards there, and they were there because there was a freshwater supply, a well there. This area of Cuba is quite arid, less than 30 inches or so of rain a year, and you can see the cactus scrubland. Laura will be talking more about that later, but anyway, this is where the final battle took place at Guantanamo, and after winning that battle, the battles of El Caney and San Juan Hill, which are much better known, of course, San Juan Hill with the Rough Riders and Teddy Roosevelt. That ended in victory. The Spanish fleet was destroyed after that. And then there was the invasion of Puerto Rico that was staged out of Guantanamo Bay. So it ended up that it was clear that Guantanamo Bay was a real asset, both to the Cubans and to the Americans. So in 1903, a lease was signed for the 45-square-mile naval reservation at Guantanamo Bay. 1934, a perpetual lease agreement was signed, and this is, of course, not recognized by Castro. He doesn't cash those $4,000 annual checks, puts them in a cigar box and just keeps them. President Roosevelt expanded the base in 1939, just prior to World War II, during which time, the war years, this the Guantanamo Bay served as a naval depot. 1961, following the Cuban Revolution and the Bay of Pigs invasion, again, Castro declared the treaty illegal, cut off the water supply to the base in 1964, which led to the construction of a desalinization plant. Again, fresh water, potable water, is obviously a critical issue at the base. And it was not until 2011 that the issues I'm talking about, the eutrophication problems in the bay, really became an issue. Now, my work in 2011 was not the first time Harbor Branch has been involved in research in Cuba. Some of you may remember the film Forbidden Depths, which was a Discovery Channel film, an expedition in the winter of 1997-98. It's the first time outsiders came to study Cuban coral reefs since the 1950s. There were four new species to science that were that came out of that work, and 26 new fish species documented in Cuban waters. That was work that Grant Gilmore was involved with. Shirley Pomponi also worked on natural products chemistry as part of that. And if you want to know more about that, the book Deep Cuba by Bill Belleville chronicles the expedition to Cuba. Now, at about that same time in the mid-90s, I was involved down in the Florida Keys really working on the science of eutrophication and what this was doing to both Florida Bay and the coral reefs of the Florida Keys. This was an emerging issue really in the late 80s and early 90s with the Everglades lawsuit. A lot of this came out in this issue of National Geographic in 1990. The Florida watershed issue had a major article about the Everglades, the problems of the Everglades pertaining to nutrient pollution from sugarcane. And it also had an article about Florida's imperiled coral reefs. And I was involved in helping the author of that article with the science in the article, and where I was, talked about the problems of nutrients, both from sewage and from agriculture. Now, the Everglades lawsuit, as it turned out, really was primarily concerned with the runoff from sugarcane coming down into the Everglades. The phosphorus in that runoff was stimulating the expansion of cattails over the native sawgrass prairies. And it didn't really concern itself with the nitrogen in the runoff, which was more of a problem in Florida Bay, the downstream waters of Florida Bay and the Florida Keys. In general, it's phosphorus that's the key limiting nutrient to algal blooms in freshwater, whereas it's nitrogen in the marine environment. So, of course, I'm seeing down here the effect of the flows of water that are being sent south. And as I think many of you know, there's a lot of sentiment right now to do that again, to send a lot more water south to prevent it from coming into the St. Lucie estuary and the Caloosahatchee. But this is what happened back in the 90s, the last time they sent the water south. It caused some very big problems in Florida Bay and the Florida Keys. You see the green water here coming out of Florida Bay. These are blooms of Senecococcus, a little cyanobacterium that actually produces toxins. So we had huge blooms develop in Florida Bay that were coming through the tidal channels of the Florida Keys that you see here. The coral reefs in the region were heavily impacted. We lost about 40% of the living coral in the Florida Keys National Marine Sanctuary between 96 and the year 2000 when this was going on. This is a picture of the reefs in southern Florida Bay near Big Pine Key. This is a large brain coral that had been living up to that point in time and died over a short span of a few years when this water was being sent south. I mean, that coral head is probably hundreds of years old and just died in the wink of an eye. You can see all the green algae. This is cladophora algae that loves the high nutrients. And you can see the orange sponge, Cleona. These are all clear symptoms of eutrophication and high nutrients. So I was studying this whole problem and publishing on it in the scientific literature, was invited to lecture in Havana in 1998 in a science exchange with the preeminent scientists, Pedro Alcalada over here, their coral reef expert, and Rodolfo Claro over here. This is part of the Instituto of Oceanography in Havana, their chemistry lab. And at the time, I had just published my paper on my nutrient threshold model, which was basically the concentration of nitrogen and phosphorus at which these problems develop, both in seagrass beds and coral reefs. And at the time, there was a lot of pushback by a lot of scientists working in South Florida. But the Cuban scientists really, really understood this. They read a lot. They're very cerebral. And they think a lot. And they had clearly read all my papers. They were quoting right out of my papers at our science exchange. It was really quite amazing. And after a day of the lecturing and exchange, we went then to look for my family house in Havana. My grandfather lived in Havana. This is my grandfather with my mother. She looks like a movie star here. I'm going, wow, it's my mother. I got to look around Cuba, around Havana in particular, right after we had the science exchange, Morro Castle, the cathedral, some of the restaurants. And after a quick tour of Havana, we all got in a bus and began to look for my grandfather's house. And it was a little bit complicated by the fact that Castro had changed the street names to numbers. And so we're going down these streets, you know, going, and I'm thinking, I think I was 2 or 3 years old when I was there, in the mid-1950s. So nothing was looking very familiar to me. And I'm thinking, oh, I don't know if this is gonna work. But you see these Spanish tiles on the wall here. As I was driving along in the bus with my wife was with me, Lee, and my colleagues, I caught a view of those tiles, and I said, stop the bus. And I jumped out and went up, and there it was, Dr. Sebastian Fernandez Roncero, my grandfather. I said, I have found our family home. Today it's used as a school for Romeo and Juliet as cigars. I thought, hey, if you're gonna lose your home, you know, to somebody. They gave me a box of Churchill cigars, by the way, and they were really great. So you can see the house, it's like a whole city block, huge tall ceilings. This is Devon and Craig Carollo, who helped set the trip up. They are the founders of Reef Relief in Key West. And we had like a little street party, and we got a tour of the house by the architect who is handling the renovation of the house. Here's my wife, Lee, here coming through the house. But you can see it's in a pretty sad state of disrepair. Be interesting to go back and see what it looks like today. Here's some of the cigar rolling desks over here. And this is the inner courtyard and garden area. There's a little carriage trail that comes in from the street. So it wasn't until some years later, around 2010, when I then got ready to go back to Cuba, this time to Guantanamo Bay. And the issue at this time was the Navy divers, and the one great thing that the Navy personnel can do at Guantanamo Bay is scuba dive. Well, wonderful reefs. Guantanamo Bay is right on the Cayman Trench, very, very deep water, drops off right in front of the bay. And what the Navy divers saw, they saw all these symptoms that we had seen in the Florida Keys years earlier, this orange sponge cleona, and the algae blooms, this is this brown algae, dictyota, overgrowing and killing their coral reefs. And it's true that Cuba, for the most part, has some of the best remaining coral reefs in the Caribbean region. They don't have the problems of mass tourism. Many large stretches of coastline aren't highly developed. They don't have a lot of fertilizers in their agricultural areas. So species like elkhorn and staghorn coral, like you see up here, we've lost over 95% of those corals in the Florida Keys on our reefs. Cuba still has quite a bit of those corals left. They're actually on the endangered species list today. But they were in trouble to some extent in Guantanamo Bay due to the problems of eutrophication. So that's why I got called down, and I'm gonna share with you just some clips right now of what these coral reefs look like in Guantanamo Bay. This is out along the coast, and this is thin lettuce coral that we don't really have in the Florida Keys, but it's down in the Central Caribbean, more in the Southern Caribbean than the Northern. And a lot of biologists that studied coral reefs at the time thought these algae blooms were simply due to overfishing of herbivorous fish, like you see here, that eat algae. But the Navy scientists and divers had been studying these reefs, and they knew that these grazers were still very abundant on these reefs, and had read my papers, and they knew this was more about eutrophication and the chemistry of the waters. This is elkhorn coral, staghorn coral. Even though these reefs are being impacted, they still have a lot more of this coral than our reefs in the Florida Keys. So the Navy was very interested in learning more about the problem. And here is the problem. Here's this brown algae, the dictyota, that you can see is expanding on what appears to be some dead coral surfaces. We have some sponges there as well that are expanding. So these reefs are clearly losing coral cover while gaining both algae and sponges. Again, clear symptoms of eutrophication. We see some green algae, some halimeda. You can see some in this shot right here, along with the brown dictyota algae. But you can see how as this algae grows and overgrows the corals, it prevents the larval corals from settling and growing. It's not just that they overgrow and smother the corals. And here you can see, again, the green halimeda algae as well as the brown algae. These are the same types of algae that have overgrown our reefs in the Florida Keys. Along with this cyanobacterium, this is Lingbia, produces toxins. We've seen a lot of this develop in the Florida Keys, and they're beginning to see that on these reefs in Guantanamo Bay as well. So the question from the Navy was, where are the nutrients coming from causing this problem? Are they coming from the bays, or are they coming from the upper watershed? And topography shapes watersheds, and this part of Cuba, again, southeastern Cuba over here, this is a topographic map. These red areas are topographic highs. And basically what happens in this region is you get a lot of funneling of the runoff down into the bay, okay? And some of this, if you look at the watershed more closely in this Google Earth image, you can see that the city of Guantanamo up here, which would be generating a lot of wastewater from a population of over 200,000 people, is right on the Guantanamo River that comes down like this and flows right in near the mouth of Guantanamo Bay. We also have the city of Caimanera right here, about 11,000 people. And you can see these features right here are salinas or salt ponds, which can also generate very high nitrogen concentrations. We learned this in our research down in Bonaire, where they also have salt ponds. These halobacteria can fix nitrogen and produce very high nitrogen concentrations from atmospheric nitrogen. So there's a lot going on the watershed. Outside the base, the fence line of the base is the lower part of Guantanamo Bay, as we'll see in some of the upcoming images. So I was contacted by the Navy. We set up a project to go down to Guantanamo, do a survey of these algae. This was our phase one study. Now, what would normally be a short flight from Fort Lauderdale to Guantanamo turned out to be actually a several-hour flight, 2.5 hours. We had to fly around Cuban airspace. Here we are coming around the eastern tip of Cuba. And as we approach Guantanamo Bay, you can, if you look carefully, you see this kind of green, discolored water flowing out of the bay. And here we are landing. You see this discolored green water flowing along the coast. That a lot of that is coming out of that Guantanamo River, okay? And you're going to hear more about that when Laura comes up in, from our phase two early results. So anyway, I checked in to the base, took the ferry from the leeward side of the base to the windward side, and checked into the swell accommodation that the Navy provided me at the time. Got an orientation around the base by Mike McCord, my Navy colleague here. And actually, we're at Cusco Bay here. He's actually telling me the history of the beginning of the Spanish-American War and where that freshwater well was. But you can see all the cacti and iguanas that are running around the base. And the namesake of the Iggy Cafe here, where we took quite a few of our meals. And of course, there's plenty of fast food that we all recognize also available on the base. So this is the study area at Guantanamo Bay. The dark line is the fence line. We could not go into Cuba. We could not cross the fence line. Now there are Cubans that come across the fence line to work every day on the base. And the base has been there long enough that some of these Cubans are actually retiring today. They have pensions, American pensions. They're probably the best paid Cubans on the island. But we had upwards of about 30 stations spread throughout the bay. Several of the stations were on the coral reefs out here in the coastal zone, where we collected macroalgae or seaweeds to measure their stable nitrogen isotope content. And I'll tell you a little bit about what that means. Here's some of that thin lettuce coral, and here's some of the macroalgae that we actually sampled at these sites. Picture of the spur and groove zone on these reefs. Again, all the beautiful coral that's still there. This is the dictyota algae that is the problem that we're collecting. And it was collected largely by the Navy colleagues shown here in my kitchen, in my apartment. Made a little laboratory out of the kitchen where we collected the algae. We sorted them, cleaned them up with distilled water to rinse all the sediment and salt off, dried them at low temperature, and then ground them to get them ready to process for the stable nitrogen isotope analysis to identify and fingerprint the source of the nitrogen. And there was one station that we couldn't sample, the Navy guys couldn't sample the algae, so I knew I had a little extra money in our budget, and I convinced them to take me up the river to a close area near the fence line to grab a water sample, and I'm going to show you what that revealed to us too. So first, these are the results from the macroalgae sampling throughout the bay and the coastal reefs. And this is how we interpret the results. The stable nitrogen isotopes, this is the ratio of N15 to N14. And that varies depending upon the source. High values typically indicate sewage nitrogen. Values above +3 parts per mil to +4 come out of septic tanks. And it goes up from there. If you have a sewage treatment plant or you have a lot of processing of the sewage nitrogen, you can get values from +5 up to +28. Now, other sources like upwelling of deep ocean nitrate, like we have here along this coast, and you can have different areas around the Caribbean, natural nitrogen fixation, atmospheric nitrogen fertilizers, all have values below that. So simply by collecting these algae, processing them, and analyzing for these isotopes, we can get basically a way to monitor these reefs for the source of nitrogen. We call these little mini observatories, okay? And this is what the results look like. Here's that +3 value, so all the values above that indicate sewage nitrogen in the bay. And where do we get the highest value? Where we get highly processed wastewater or stormwater at the outfall. This is right at the end of the pipe. This is exactly the value we get when we take a sample at the end of a sewage outfall, for example, down off the southeast coast of Florida. These values are also very enriched, around 6 parts per mil. This is roughly what the Indian River Lagoon algae also average. Okay, if you've heard me speak on the very similar work to this that we're doing in the lagoon, we're getting very similar values, and this is what first clued us in that we have a sewage problem in our Indian River Lagoon. Now, as we go out the bay to the coastal reef sites and the bay mouth, you see how those values drop down, but they're not really much under 3. So those reefs are seeing some wastewater nitrogen, even though it's much diluted compared to up in the middle bay. Now, if we look at the different types of the seaweeds or macroalgae, there's reds, greens, and browns. These are the different phyla of the seaweeds. Here's some examples of a red, a green, another green, and here's several, 3 different types of brown algae that were sampled in the bay. We see that the reds have the highest values, around +6. Greens, very similar, a little lower. The browns, the lowest value. And the browns are the ones that predominate out on the reefs offshore, where it's more dilute sewage reaching those areas compared to the middle and upper bay here, where we have the higher values. And this is very much like the Indian River Lagoon. These reds and greens are what predominate, where we get very high concentrations of wastewater in the lagoon. So that water sample I took in the Guantanamo River, here's what we found. We found it had about 16 micromolar dissolved inorganic nitrogen. Now, what does that mean? How high is that? Well, this one micromolar is that threshold I was telling you about. When values go above that, coral reefs begin to suffer from too much nitrogen. And in fact, you can see Lou Key over here in the 1980s, before the water went south, was averaging, this is an annual average or a decadal average, of about 0.5. We still had pretty healthy coral reefs in the Florida Keys. The water was clear, not a lot of green water. After the water went south, it more than doubled, more than 100% increase. Okay, a lot of green water hit that reef, and that's when we lost most of our coral. Okay, you can see, basically, what are we looking at? We're looking at like a dilution curve. You remember the saying, the solution to pollution is dilution? Well, the problem is the nutrient concentrations now in our coastal waters are getting so high that we're trying to dilute it. These river discharges have such high concentrations of nitrogen that we can no longer safely dilute them in places like the Indian River Lagoon or Guantanamo Bay. This is the St. Lucie River in 2005 after the hurricanes. Remember the blooms of the green goo, the microcystis, the toxic algae? That's why we had all those problems. Here's the Guantanamo River. Just under the Guantanamo River are the Indian River County canals that drain Indian River farms. All those septic tanks leaking nitrogen, flowing through the groundwater into the canals and into the lagoon. This is the global average for rivers. This is the Amazon River, which actually happens to be fairly clean, relatively clean. And then you see these little Lou Key values down here. So this is basically a dilution curve. We're bringing these nutrients in from rivers and canals and tidal creeks into our coastal waters. That's how the nitrogen is being delivered and causing this problem. So after we got the results, I wrote the report for the Navy and made recommendations that we begin to look at nutrient concentrations throughout the bay to better understand not just the concentrations but the ratios also of nitrogen to phosphorus. And what happened in 2013, a brown tide emerged in the bay. You can see all this green and brown water. As you know, we had a brown tide in the Mosquito Lagoon. This is the Mosquito Lagoon in 2012. Following year, Guantanamo Bay, first time ever a brown tide in the Caribbean region. So this does not bode well for the Caribbean. This is the organism, Oreumbra lagunensis. So my phone rang after this happened. Navy said, well, you remember those recommendations you made? We think we want to look more into the problem of nutrients here. And please send us a scope of work and a budget. And that's when Laura Hara had started with me. And she's going to come up now and tell you a little bit about what we're doing right now to help the Navy better understand this problem.
Okay, so as you can imagine, we were really excited about the opportunity to go back down to Guantanamo Bay and continue the work that we started back in 2011. One of my primary roles in this phase two project was to make sure all of the logistics were covered. And so we had 3 weeks from the time that the funding was awarded to the time we wanted to be down there conducting research. So obviously, we really needed to fast track our security clearance forms. And let me tell you, this is a really great way to get to know your supervisor better. We also had to book our flights, and there are two different ways that you can fly down to the base. One out of Jacksonville on an internal military flight on what they call the rotator, or you can go down to Fort Lauderdale and take a commercial carrier over, which is what we ended up doing. So I had 3 weeks to make sure we had all of the supplies purchased and shipped over to Guantanamo Bay. You cannot just directly ship things, obviously, to a high-security military base. So the workaround was to ship everything up to Jacksonville, where it went down on the rotator or on a barge. And thankfully, everything was there when we got down to the base in late September. So in addition to Brian and I, the rest of the Phase 2 team included a researcher from McMaster University in Ontario, another researcher from Dauphin Island Marine Lab in Alabama, and then we had three very supportive members of the Navy that assisted beforehand and during the entire week that we were down there. The main goal for Brian and I when we went down was to set up this water quality monitoring network. It consisted of 12 sites. Two sites are in the Guantanamo River. Two sites, sites 5 and 6, are coastal on the nearshore reefs. And then the remaining sites were all in this lower portion of Guantanamo Bay. And so this past September, what we were doing is, Brian and I were doing, is training the Navy environmental staff so that they could go out and collect water samples on a monthly basis for us. So, and when they collect water, they're collecting them for dissolved nutrients, chlorophyll A, which is a proxy for those algal blooms that Brian was talking about. We did more stable isotope work. This time, instead of it being the benthic macroalgae, we ran stable isotope analyses on the plankton that was in the water column. And then we also looked at water clarity. So the next slide is going to be a short video, and we're going to start at Site 6 along the coast. Then we're going to go up the Guantanamo River, and we're going to end at Site 5, which is over here by the airport. Okay, so this is Cuzco, one of the coastal sites. And what we're doing is walking through the standard operating procedures that we use here at Harbor Branch when we collect our water samples. And this is just a small probe that we use to take very basic environmental parameters like water temperature and salinity. And you can see how clear the water is. Okay, so the two coastal sites you can access by land, but the remaining sites we had to access by boat. So here we're going up the Guantanamo River, and one of the most striking features were the red mangroves and their long drop roots. This isn't something that you see very often in Florida. And I want you to take note of the color of the water here. Notice how green it looks. We're going to circle back around to that in just a couple of minutes. It's a great egret, the same bird as we have here in Florida. This is the second coastal site. And here, we're training another environmental staff. We're training Mark. And Mark is the person who primarily is responsible for collecting these water samples every month for us. So what Mark does is after he collects the samples, he processes them, he filters them back in a wet lab that we set up for him. And then he freezes the samples. They're sent to Jacksonville, on that rotator plane, and then from Jacksonville, they're sent to the University of Georgia at their analytical chemistry lab. And then the University of Georgia sends us the data. Okay, so here's the wet lab that we set up for them in the Public Works building. And I'm just going to show you one slide with some of our preliminary results. These are the results for chlorophyll A, again, that proxy for those algal blooms. We've got the sites 1 through 12 down here, and the chlorophyll concentration 0 through 60 here. And site 1, you can see, is pretty high, 55 micrograms per liter. And that's the site up here in the area that we were filming. And you can see how green that water was. We suspected that there was an algal bloom going on while we were there, but the data actually confirmed that. The water quality monitoring network is a great way to get some snapshots of what's happening, the current conditions in the bay every month. But remember I said we had a couple of other colleagues that went down to the base with us, and they were primarily looking at the history of eutrophication in Guantanamo Bay. And they were doing that by collecting these clams that live 30, 40 plus years. And they were lucky enough to actually find some fossilized clam shells as well. And they were able to do that because small portions of the base were underwater at one point. It was part of a spur and groove reef habitat. And spur and groove reef is basically just you have spurs of coral that are separated by troughs of sand. And so here you can see one of the spurs with just generation after generation after generation of coral built up. And then intermixed with the coral, there were some clams. And so after work, we ate some phenomenal food. And I really enjoyed walking along the beach. There is a ton of sea glass there. We had a little gator that the Navy gave us to go and see other sites on the base. So we kept pretty busy. Okay, so now I'm going to get into a little bit of the natural history of Cuba, and then I'm going to narrow down on Guantanamo Bay. So on a global scale, the world can be divided into about 8 different biogeographic zones. And Cuba is in the neotropical zone here. And that basically means that the plants and animals in Cuba are most similar to those found in Miami, the Florida Keys, Central America, and South America. And as you're going to see, Cuba is a really unique place. And one of the many factors that contribute to that is the movement of the Earth's crust in this area. So I've got a couple of different perspectives of the same area up here, but you can see this is the Caribbean plate here, and this is the North American plate up here, and they basically collide right here along the coast, southeast coast of Cuba. And where they come together, you have these deep trenches. You've got the Puerto Rican trench over here, above Puerto Rico, and then along the southeast edge of Cuba, you've got the Cayman Trench. And so basically when, and Brian already alluded to this, you come out of Guantanamo Bay, and then you hit a wall. And so it's a deep drop-off down to several thousand feet. It's great wall diving, and a lot of people go out there to deep water fish, or deep sea fish. Here again is the Caribbean plate and the North American plate. And so when the two collide, in addition to those deep trenches, you also have the buckling of the land. And so you've got a mountain range down here. And just like Brian mentioned about topography shaping the watershed of Guantanamo Bay, topography also shapes ecology. And I have a map down here of the ecoregions of Cuba. It shows the 6 main habitat types in Cuba. And I'm going to cover just a couple of those. And one of the most obvious here, the mountain ranges are this is high elevation here. And you can see it correlates nicely with the green signatures down here, which are the Cuban rainforests. And the other feature that I wanted to point out is the Zapata swamp. The Zapata swamp is like the Florida Everglades of Cuba. It's the largest and most well-protected wetland in the Caribbean, the most pristine in the Greater Antilles, and it's the last remaining refuge for the most rare crocodile in the world, the Cuban crocodile. So the habitat type around Guantanamo Bay is called cactus scrubland. And obviously it's very, very dry there, you can see in the picture. And the reason for that is because you basically have this warm air coming off of the ocean. It rises up over the mountains that are surrounding Guantanamo Bay. The air cools, it precipitates down into those rainforests, and then the dry air comes over Guantanamo Bay. So it's in the rain shadow. And these are just examples of the different types of cactus scrubland that Brian and I saw on the base. Cactus-dominated scrubland, more woody vegetation-dominated scrubland, and then the coastal scrubland. Now, whether planned or not, the 45-square-mile military base is really functioning as a nature preserve. Almost 90% of the area is still pristine and serves as habitat for the native plants and animals. This is a view of the cactus scrubland and some mountains in the background. These are the most distinct cactus. They're called organ pipe cactus. And about 10 years ago, the military put in 4 wind turbines that generate 25% of the energy used on the base. The other 75% is diesel generators. And this is an area called Graffiti Hill. And Brian and I went to Graffiti Hill with Peter Tolson, who's the director of conservation at the Toledo Zoo. And Brian's taking this video here. And this is, Peter basically does all of the wildlife studies, many of the wildlife studies in the on the base. And this is a real hot spot for biodiversity. It's got a dried up riverbed here with some pools of water that support wildlife like this curly-tailed lizard. And although this is more of a woody, shrubby-dominated system, there are still several cacti and agaves. And there is still some, we were there in September, so there was some running water that supports some of the amphibians as well. These are toad eggs. For those of you who don't know, toads lay eggs in long strands like this. And there were tadpoles there as well that didn't make it into the video. So this was Graffiti Hill during the day. And Peter and I went back out to Graffiti Hill at night. We put on headlamps and we walked down the riverbed looking for the Cuban boa. Peter has a long-term tracking study for boas, and I was really hopeful, but we didn't end up finding any boas. But we saw all sorts of other wildlife, including the species of toad that laid those eggs. They were just hanging out in the pools of water. So Cuba really is an island of extremes. It's got the smallest bird in the world, the smallest bat in the Western Hemisphere, the smallest frog in the Northern Hemisphere, and as I mentioned earlier, the most rare and aggressive crocodile in the world. And one of the things that makes Cuba so important on a global scale is its high number of endemic species, meaning the number of species that are only found there in Cuba. And it's important Here's Cuba here. You can see the other areas that have a high number of endemicism are the other Greater Antilles, the Panama and Costa Rica, as well as Ecuador, which has the Galapagos. So for example, there are 29 species of reptiles in Cuba. 21 are endemic to Cuba, and 4 of them are endemic to the area just around the base. So I'm just going to cover a few of those endemics. This is one of the most charismatic of the endemic species. It's a large rodent called the hutia, also known as the banana rat. And these guys are found up in the trees during the day. Sometimes they burrow. And they're very, very, very rare off the base. And very, very abundant on the base, to the point where they're a problematic species. Okay, and another endemic is the Cuban rock iguana, which is one of the largest iguanas. It can be over 5 feet from the tip of the nose to the end of the tail. And an estimated 6 to 8% of all of the Cuban rock iguanas are found on the base. That's 2,000 to 3,000 individuals. And as you can see by the pictures here, they're pretty much everywhere. And then I'm going to end my portion of the talk with the hawksbill sea turtle. Here in this part of Florida, we have green turtles nesting and leatherbacks and loggerheads. So I've seen all of those, but I've never had the opportunity to see a hawksbill nesting. And so this was at Cuzco Beach. It's a real rare nester in Florida. So this was a real treat for me. I'm going to turn it over to Brian again.
Well, I think as you could see, it was really great having Laura along with me on that phase two study. And actually, some of the best times in both the studies happened after working hours, actually, at the dock of the bay. I can't tell you how much science we talked about over a few brewskis and sipping a little rum and smoking a cigar or two. Not Cuban cigars, though. And eating some wonderful grilled fresh seafood. Lobster, conch. Anyone know what this fish is? Misty grouper. Came out 700 feet of water, caught by Mike McCord, our environmental biologist that we worked with there on the base. And we would sit around and talk about the science of the day and watch the sunset. It was really, really wonderful. These guys took great care of us. So moving forward, a lot of what we talked about is where the science has to go, and clearly the results are showing a lot of the problem is not coming from the base itself, but from the Cuban watershed above the base. And because of what's happening right now with the normalization of travel and trade policies with Cuba, it's going to get a lot easier for me to go to Cuba to work with my colleagues, my Cuban colleagues, like Pedro Alcala and Rodolfo Claro. We're already seeing some effects in the Florida Keys of these new rules. The Cubans are actually fearful that as this proceeds, there will be no more wet foot, dry foot policy in the U.S., so they're trying to come now. And we've seen a huge spike of Cuban chugs, you know, coming across. We can see, actually, these are a couple chugs right at Guantanamo Bay. Of immigrants trying to come into the U.S. base. This was a recent chug that came across just in January on Sombrero Beach in Marathon. So I think it's great that from here on out, I don't need a license or a special permit from the Treasury Department to go to Cuba. I have to work. I have to do research. I can't go there and just lay on the beach and drink rum and smoke cigars. I have to really be able to be accountable for the work, and that's really a great thing, I think. So just to close up, I want to thank a lot of people. Obviously, the Navy folks we worked with have just been great to us, so supportive of the work. My science colleagues, Mike Risk, Ruth Carmichael, have been great. As I mentioned, Pedro and Rodolfo are ready to take this to the next level with me, with my team, and go up there and perhaps sample the Guantanamo River right near the city of Guantanamo. Look at those salinas in the upper bay, what's going on up there, to begin to look at really trying to moderate the problems that are happening in Guantanamo Bay. Also, those of you who saw the wonderful photography in the preview show, the Cuban photography and music, that was by Dink Bruce, one of my friends from Key West, and Tom Jackson. A lot of Harbor Branch people, Pam Alderman, helped with a lot of literature search for our research down there. Brian Cousin with the video editing, and of course a lot of people in my lab who helped as well. And our colleagues up at the Odom School of Ecology who are analyzing the phase two samples. And last but not least, I did want to do a little shout out to my father, George Lapointe. You saw the picture of my mother earlier. I figured, well, I've got to give equal time to my dad. He was a sailor in the Navy in World War II in the Pacific, and sadly he died when I was only 9 years old. He was 39, but not before we did a lot of fishing together, trout fishing in western Massachusetts, and he also took me to South Florida as a young boy and Cuba. And it really taught me the love of the outdoors and our natural resources and the need for conservation. So thank you, Dad, for showing me the way. And it was his dream, actually, to retire in the Florida Keys. So I think that's pretty cool. So I just want to end on this note. And you know, the best thing about the new travel rules is that we can now legally bring back Cuban rum and cigars. Thank you.